Be here at KPFA 94.1 FM in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. Please stay tuned for A Rude Awakening.
This is A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. On today's show, I'll speak to Patricia Osage, Executive Director of Alameda County's Life Elder Care and Lavender Seniors, on the plight of elder care for the LGBTQI community. And David Bacon, photojournalist and published author, on the need for media freelancers to get organized. Stay tuned. And here to talk about the particular focus on the conference of the 13 segments, which focuses on LGBTQI and Two-Spirit elders, is Patricia Osage. And she's the executive director of Life Elder Care and Lavender Seniors of the East Bay in Alameda County. And she's also a social justice advocate and author of Connecting with Socially Isolated Seniors, which is published by Health Professions Press. Miss Patricia Osei, thank you so much for being on A Rude Awakening.
Thank you so much for having me. Glad to be here.
All right. Now, I mean, this is a rude awakening for a lot of folks. We're talking about a segment of the community that is hardly ever spoken about, and that's the seniors of the LGBTQI and Two-Spirit segment of the society. What exactly are the two main concerns when it comes to LGBTQI older adults and mental health? Like, how are those two connected?
Sure. So LGBT, and let me actually preface by saying that during this project, which is about LGBTQI2S, we discovered that elders who are LGBT don't want to be referred to as LGBTQQI2S. That's too much for them.
Right.
It's too much for me.
Right.
And so while it's a wonderful term that, you know, aims at being inclusive of many people, LGBT baby boomers they prefer the term LGBT in general, speaking generally, that's what we found.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm gonna use that phrase instead, LGBT.
Thank you.
So LGBT elders, you know, they came of age in a pretty different era than today's LGBT youth and young adults.
Mm-hmm.
I think everybody would agree that there's been a lot of advancement recently around social justice rights for the LGBT population.
Mm-hmm.
But they did not grow up with that. They grew up in a time of sanctioned oppression, a lot of discrimination by society and law, religious institutions. You know, there was this, a pervasive message that their authentic selves, who they were, was sick and criminal.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's not something you just get over because marriage is now legal, you know, across the U.S., which is an amazing, wonderful thing that a lot of folks never thought they would see. And they're so happy about that, but there's some ambiguity because, you know, you can imagine, right? There's some grief around that because when they grew up and came of age, loving who you wanted to love, marrying who you were in love with was not okay, and they had to hide.
Right, right. And the pain of that. And then on top of that, there was, during that time, especially the 40s, 50s, and before that, there was the only, the solution of the status quo, the solution for this particular problem, quote unquote, was to be institutionalized. So that fear of being ripped out of a world and, you know, piece of society that you've created for yourself, you know, just to correct whatever society thought was wrong with you was to be institutionalized, which is huge. So I would imagine there was a level of deterrent to keep folks from seeking any type of help, even to this day, because of that horrifying conditioning of the times that they became of age, correct?
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I mean, you know, their relationships, their careers, and their safety, like you said, because they could be actually locked up for being who they were. They were, you know, so all these things, they felt pretty much constantly at risk. So, you know, it's really not surprising that as a result, this subset of elders, you can call it, suffers from really high rates of mental and physical health issues.
Right, right.
Especially suicide. You know, 39% of LGBT elders over age 60 have seriously contemplated suicide, and many have tried.
Oh my God.
I mean, isolation itself is now known as a pretty big issue amongst elders in general, right?
Right.
But far more so for those who grew up LGBT in that era. Mm-hmm. You know, they are 3 to 4 times less likely to have children, twice as likely to live alone, twice as likely to be single. You know, there's a lot of internalized homophobia, right, because of people's own families of origin often disown them. You know, that's a lot to deal with, you know. You would have to be pretty enlightened not to come out of that traumatized somehow.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Which brings us to this, the safe invisible. What is safe invisible, Patricia Osage?
Okay, so safe invisible is an online, it's cloud-based, free training tool that has several modules, and basically what it tries to teach is, one, what we've been talking about, the social ramifications of having grown up and come of age as an LGBT person in the 50s through the 80s, really, and even a little bit beyond. It teaches how to identify some of the common, you know, mental health care issues that are more pervasive, again, that we've been talking about, and how to become familiar with ways to signal the community that your healthcare practice is welcoming. So it's targeted to healthcare providers. So therapists, social workers, doctors, but it's also easily translatable to really anybody who works with elders in the community. So administrators of assisted living facilities, that kind of thing. But it has very specific role vignettes that demonstrate exactly how to use the tools in the film to create a welcoming healthcare practice. So there's a lot of great trainings out there. Mm-hmm. There's even some online trainings mm-hmm. around working with the LGBT population and the LGBT elder population. They are, for the most part, pretty dry. A lot of PowerPoints.
No, that makes it real personal, right?
A lot of, you know, I mean, it's wonderful that it's out there, right? It's good to have all these tools,
right.
But there's nothing that is really engaging and really shows what it's like to be an LGBT elder. Okay. And so Lavender Seniors of the East Bay, mm-hmm. This incredible organization that was formed 20 years ago, the last 10 years have been doing an in-person training for people who accepted it, like the senior affordable housing sites, that kind of thing. Mm-hmm. So what they would do is bring in a panel of LGBT elders mm-hmm. and do a presentation, do a big Q&A, and then provide materials, and that group of people would be well trained. Mm-hmm. The problem is that, one, it's very time consuming, it's very resource intensive, and there's staff turnover. So it's nigh impossible to maintain that level of education around mm-hmm. the dire need of being very sensitive to LGBT elders in a way that is different from other elders, from their non-LGBT counterparts, and also very different from the way one approaches LGBT youth. Very different, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so to tackle that, basically what we tried to do was take that training and just translate it into this cloud-based tool.
Nice. That is brilliant. That is brilliant. Thank goodness for the cloud, right? So it's not just some, you know, after some seminar, there's just some tape that gets popped in and then forgotten about, you know. It's like, okay, here's part of your required training. Let's just pop this tape in. You can update it and do all that cool technical stuff as needed, as your organization and as Alameda County starts realizing the different changes that are coming about. Since this is so new, I would imagine that there's still a lot of bases that need to be covered, correct?
That's exactly right, yes. And so it's easy to access. Anybody can access it. People can incorporate it as part of their new staff training. There's, you know, 5 basic modules. There's some downloadable resources, some really like quick view lists that people can print out and put on their office wall. It talks about this emblem, which is a very, very key part of the whole approach at projecting the fact that you are welcoming in your practice or wherever you are. It's a small thing, right? It's a sticker, right? Mm-hmm. It's a sticker with a rainbow on it.
Mm-hmm.
And it seems very basic, and it is, but it goes so far. It's this amazing thing. It was initially a project funded by the Horizons Foundation in the city.
Right.
And you can download it, or you can write to us, and we will send you a bunch of them. And you just put it up right outside your office. You can put it in the right at the front door.
That was brilliant.
Most people don't even notice it, but if you're LGBT and you're an LGBT elder, you focus right in on it.
You know what's up.
Yes.
That
and
is
you know,
wonderful.
I mean, I know myself as being part of the LGBT community. When I see a rainbow somewhere, mm-hmm. I immediately feel a little bit better, and I'm pretty confident. I'm out, but mm-hmm. if I see a rainbow somewhere, I know somewhere somebody gets me, that I am visible and safe.
Right, right. And you know, the name of this whole module and the training program, whatnot, is just, it's such a great name, too, Safe and Visible. I mean, you can't get any more blatant than that. Hey, you're safe, and we see you, and you're married, so come on in. Real quick, we got like 2-3 minutes left here. Patricia Osage, Executive Director of Life Elder Care and Lavender Seniors of the East Bay in Alameda County, social justice advocate. Really quickly, whose idea was this? And where can
I'll
people
tell you,
get
it? It was not my idea. It is all credit must go to Dan Ashbrook.
All right, Dan. Yeah.
Dan Ashbrook. He was, this is something he's wanted for a long, long time.
Oh,
and he was the director of Lavender Seniors for a decade. And he is an LGBT elder activist and brilliant all-around person.
Nice. Right on, Dan. We give a shout-out to Dan right here from Rude Awakening for giving our listeners a rude awakening with the creation of this module, I guess you could call it, training program, etc. Where can the commoners like ourselves, can we get that information or download it? Can we download it and check it out, you know, to just to make ourselves more educated as far as LGBT seniors are concerned?
Absolutely. Anybody can go to this. And in fact, over 600 students have already taken it.
Nice.
And get this. Mm-hmm. It's been taken in over 60 countries around the world.
Shut up. That's wonderful.
Isn't that amazing? Russia, Pakistan,
what?
India.
Wait. Pakistan, India? Wow.
Yeah. Only 300 of those students are in the U.S. The other 300 are around the world.
This has had
beyond, you know, what we ever dreamed. But you go to the platform. It's a learning platform called Udemy, U-D-E-M-Y, udemy.com.
Mm-hmm.
The title is Creating a Healthcare Practice Welcoming to LGBT Seniors. So it's, you know, udemy.com/ Creating a Healthcare Practice Welcoming to LGBT Seniors. You just click Start Learning Now. You enter your name and email, create a password, and boom, you start the course. If that's a lot to remember, just write to us at info@lavenderseniors.org.
All right, info@lavenderseniors.org. And hey, you know what? If you didn't catch all that, you can Google Safe and Visible LGBT Seniors. I'm sure that all this information is going to come up in your Google Bing search, what have you. Miss Patricia Osage, thank you so much for taking the time out. I know you are a very, very busy woman, and we appreciate all the information that you've given us here at A Rude Awakening. Thank you so much for being on the show.
Thank you, Sabrina. Such a pleasure.
In his latest piece titled Why Freelancers Need to Get Together, published in the online periodical Guild Freelancers, David Bacon, who is a writer, a photojournalist based in Oakland and Berkeley, discusses the importance of camaraderie among freelance media folks. Mr. Bacon is the author of several books about migration and globalization, The Children of NAFTA, out through University of California Press, 2004, Communities Without Borders, out through ILR, Cornell University Press, 2006, Illegal People, How Globalization Creates Migration and Criminalizes Immigrants, Beacon Press, 2008, and The Right to Stay Home, which is his latest publication, through Beacon Press as well, 2013. Mr. David Bacon, welcome to A Rude Awakening.
It's a pleasure to be on KPFA once again.
All right. It's a pleasure to have you. Now, I've been receiving your newsletter since we exchanged contact info after the Berkeley-Ferguson Solidarity Uprising in December of 2014, and I've been wanting to have you on the show ever since. So it's great to finally have you on. And now you've been working as a, or you've been a factory worker and union organizer for about two decades, including several years with the United Farm Workers, the UE, the ILGWU, and other unions. But you've been doing the media thing for close to two decades. What made you write this particular article, talking about your experience as a freelance media person?
Well, it's a blatant pitch for people to join the union.
Right.
It was posted on our union website. So I've been a member of the newspaper guild since probably 1985, somewhere in there. So a long time, 30 years maybe plus. And during all of that time, I've been a freelance writer. I never worked on the staff of, like a daily newspaper like the Chronicle. I've written freelance articles for the Chronicle and for other daily newspapers, but I never worked as a staff writer for them. And for many of those years, our union was not that interested in freelancers. In fact, really, in the eyes of people who work for daily newspapers, this is sort of the way it used to be in the old days, staff writers would look at freelancers as kind of a threat, partly because publishers would try to convince freelancers to cross picket lines and go to work during strikes. I'm glad to say that that was almost always unsuccessful, but they tried. And then also, we were kind of like the cheap labor threat that publishers would use during contract negotiations. In other words, if the staff writers in the union had proposals on the table for increasing benefits and increasing wages, the publishers would say, well, there's a lot of hungry writers out there, so don't be too greedy. In the last 10 years, our union especially, our local union especially out here on the West Coast, And our union has local unions in New York and in Washington, all over the country. And so we're the sort of the West Coast. We're called the Pacific Media Workers. We began to get a lot more interested in organizing freelance writers for a lot of reasons. One reason was that, the newsrooms of daily newspapers have been cut and cut and cut and cut. People have been laid off. People have been pressured into taking buyouts. And so all of a sudden, people who were staff writers getting regular salary are themselves trying to survive as freelancers. And so they became a more powerful voice in our union, advocating for the union paying more attention. And then the other thing is just simply that, especially in the days of the internet, most of the content out there is being produced by people who do not have a sort of an employer-employee relationship with the people that they write for. In other words, we're freelancers.
Right.
And so, our union is sort of recognizing this reality and saying, well, okay, the needs of freelancers really are not that different from the needs of staff writers. We all produce the content. We all have to live off of what, we're getting paid here. Mm-hmm. And the big difference is that freelancers get a lot less. So it's a lot harder to live off of what we get paid.
Most definitely. Now, in your article, you state, but for freelancers especially, getting together means overcoming some serious obstacles. To begin with, even if we're given a contract at all, and mostly we work on a handshake or verbal commitment, and you got that right. The first thing it says is that we're independent contractors, not employees. What type of blowback can freelancers expect if there's an attempt to unionize? And what have you seen in your experience?
Well, I think that you know, for instance, when we tried to convince the Huffington Post to pay freelancers, you know, a lot of people write for the Huffington Post for nothing. And then there are some people who, you know, try to get paid. So what happened? If we try to get together, publishers tell us, and this is the New York Times. There was a famous New York Times case where they say, you're independent contractors. And because you're independent contractors, if you try to get together and set rates, you're violating the Sherman Antitrust Act, which is a complete ridiculous. I don't know what to call it on the radio because let's say ridiculous, right?
Yes.
They're talking about us as though we were some monopoly corporation. Mm-hmm. So our response to that, I think, is, well, we are going to try and move towards doing that anyway. We're going to try and establish what we think are a livable rate that freelancers should get paid. And if publishers think that we are violating the Sherman Antitrust Act, then great, arrest us.
And what exactly is the Sherman Antitrust Act for those of us who do not know what that is or have never heard of it?
So the Sherman Antitrust Act wasn't really intended to apply to workers. It was really a pro-consumer law that said that corporations couldn't get together and fix prices. But, you know, again, you know, here they're trying to use this against ordinary people like us and say, well, you're just like a corporation. You can't get together and fix prices for the articles that you're writing or the photographs that you're taking. And, you know, I think our answer to that is, you know, get real, you know, don't be ridiculous. You know, we're not General Motors here. We are freelancers, and we're trying to survive.
Exactly. I mean, especially you have a really good example in your article where someone can get paid $1,000 for writing an article, say, for one of the top-notch agencies or what have you, like New York Times or what have you. And nowadays, you know, we're lucky to get 100, you know. And I mean, that's huge. That's such a huge, huge twist, you know. It's just a downward spiral.
Well, and what that's really talking about is what's happened to us as freelancers in the move towards digital media.
Right.
So, of course, back in the days before we had the Internet, there were still plenty of freelancers writing articles for magazines, say. And so what I'm saying here is that in those days, if I were to write an article for certain print magazines, which shall remain nameless here, you know, I might get $1,000.
Yeah.
If once these magazines set up websites, the websites publish a lot more material than the magazines do. Mm-hmm. And so the magazines would then say, well, in order to fill up the website, you know, we can't afford to pay what we're paying for print articles, so we'll just cut it. And so they cut it, you know, down to, well, in some cases, a tenth of what they were paying for a print article. The trouble is that for a writer, it takes as much time to write an article for a website as it does to write it for a magazine. And for a photographer, you know, it takes exactly the same amount of time to take and process a photograph for the Internet as it does for print. So from our perspective, the only thing that changed really was that our rates became unlivable. And of course, you know, if you think about it, Sabrina, if you're getting $100 for an article, think of what your rent is. How many articles would you have to write a month just to pay your rent? But let's not even talk about having to eat.
Yeah, let's keep that out of it.
Medical care, as much as retirement. You know?
I know. You know what? I would have to do at least 8 to 10 just to stay barely afloat.
There you go.
And it's beyond ridiculous. Now, where do we start? Where do we start as freelancers? How do we make this a reality for folks who aren't connected or haven't been connected to a union like you? How can we start protecting ourselves? Are there unions out there that are open to freelancers in the media?
Yes, there are. So in our case, you know, we're talking about freelancers who do writing, photography. We also have interpreters who belong to our union, and people who do graphic arts. And so all of those people belong to our union. And so, you know, one of the things that you can do if you're interested is you can simply join the union and then begin participating in our efforts to sort of get those rates up. I don't want to say that we're the only union doing this. You know, the National Writers Union is out there, and then there are unions who are interested in helping people organize who are freelancers doing other kinds of work, mm-hmm. in other words, not media work. Mm-hmm. You know, tech people, for instance, there's a tech workers union up in Seattle, and there's some other ones out there. But in our case, you know, what we are trying to do is we are trying to talk to people who work in the media. And so our idea about how we can begin to get those rates to go up is, first of all, we have to be able to talk about it.
That's right.
You know, one of the things that we need to do is we need to tell each other mm-hmm. how much we're making so that we can begin to see what's being paid out there mm-hmm. and then come up with what we think is a realistic base. Yeah. You know, that's where we're at right now. We're not really talking about what the top of the line should be. We're talking about what the bottom should be. In other words, not less than. Mm-hmm. And so that's kind of where we're at in terms of our campaign. And we would certainly welcome anybody who's interested in participating in it to participate in any way that you feel comfortable, for sure.
All right. Amazing, amazing information there for all you freelance media folk from the amazing Mr. David Bacon. Mr. David Bacon, his latest piece is called Why Freelancers Need to Get Together, and it's published in the online periodical Guild Freelancers. And Mr. David Bacon, thank you so much. You're definitely helping me out, that's for sure, because I'm a volunteer here at KPFA, as you were probably a volunteer during the morning show when you were on. So.
Oh, yeah. Years.
So we know how it is, and we know that this is a passion of the heart. And you know what? We need to get paid for that. Mr. David Bacon, thank you so much for the info. Thank you for being on A Rude Awakening.
Well, thank you, Sabrina, for inviting me on. Appreciate it.
And here's an important announcement, a very important announcement, from Community Advisory Board member Robin House Collins.
The Community Advisory Board for KPFA is having a community input meeting on March 26th from 2 to 4 at the South Berkeley Library, Taria Pittman Library, located at 1901 Russell Street. We're getting programmers together with the community to hear what community would like to hear. We want to get as many people as we can and get as much input as we can to the station, so they know what's important to our listeners. We're also trying to get more youth into the radio. Please come to our meeting March 26th, that's Saturday, from 2 to 4. Again, it's at the South Berkeley Library, Taria Pittman Library, 1901 Russell Street in Berkeley. We hope to see you there.
And that does it for another edition of A Rude Awakening. I'm Sabrina Jacobs. A huge thank you to my guests, Patricia Osage, David Bacon, Robin House Collin. I'll be back next week, same time, same place. Heart Knock Radio's up next. Have a great week, everybody, and thanks for listening.
Just in time for KPFA's birthday, Amy Goodman is coming to Berkeley to launch her new book, Democracy Now! 20 Years Covering the Movement Changing America. On Sunday, April 17th, Amy will take the stage with her brother and co-author David to present two decades of history-making journalism. That's at the First Congregational Church of Berkeley, 2345 Channing Way, starting at 7:30 p.m. and hosted by me, Brian Edwards-Tiegert. There's wheelchair access, tickets available in advance through brownpapertickets.com and local independent bookstores, and full details on our website, kpfa.org. It is a very happy birthday to Democracy Now! And to KPFA with Amy Goodman on April 17th. See you there.
It is now 4 o'clock here at KPFA, 94.1 FM in Berkeley, 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online at kpfa.org. Stay tuned for her.